Good morning, everybody. I'm just going to bring this up on my laptop and do a couple of shares. We've been having so many difficulties with our internet. It's not even funny. They told us they would come out on Thursday after being on the phone with them an hour and 45 minutes on Sunday. Started on Saturday having intermittent problems. TVs stopped working. It was just a gong show. And, you know, we have a TV upstairs, we've got the media room, my mum's got a TV in her room, we've got TV in the gym, and you know what, we were a little bit lost without the TV, to say the least. On the weekends, we always like to watch a movie Friday night or Saturday night. That's our guilty pleasure, chips and apples and cheese and all kinds of goodies. And anyway, all these issues with the internet, and I didn't know if I was going to be live this morning, but here I am. So good morning, everybody. How are you? Hi, Paul. I didn't know you were going to be here. I thought you and Dali were, Dali's got a workshop, I take it. But anyway, we got the internet back, and it's great to see you, Paul. Good morning, Terry. Good morning, Debbie. But Dali, I don't think, is here today, right, Paul? She's got a workshop. Gonna miss her. Anyway, so I didn't know if I was gonna be able to do a live this morning, and I actually didn't prepare for a live this morning till yesterday evening, because I managed to figure out all it needed was basically reset on the main motherboard of our cable system and internet. Anyway, it took a couple of hours, but we got it figured out. So last night I was scrambling to get a Facebook Live done. So if I'm a little bit disheveled today, it's because I did this really late last night. I was up at 5 stressing about it, but then I managed to go back to sleep. So bear with me today if I have to go grab some stuff and things like that. Just before I start though, yeah, she has a 2-hour workshop. Okay, thanks, Paul. I thought so. Good morning, Bonnie. And so I will miss Dali, but Paul, I'll let you, if there's any questions, you can answer if you're still hanging about. Just a quick couple of updates. They've furthered the restrictions, extended them till January the 8th, so there will be no classes going on at Volcanic Hills Winery. So this weekend's class is cancelled, and I'm actually quite relieved it's cancelled, because even if they had lifted the restrictions, I was not really willing to put that class on, just for the safety of everybody and myself and family, of course. So no classes. I'll let everybody know that was signed up. And this weekend, I'm doing 2 Facebook Lives in a private group with Tamara Morton at Memories Paper Art. If you haven't done these classes and would like to do them, we have the kits available, depending on if you have the products or not, the embellishment kits. However, this Facebook Live will be available to you whenever you're ready to do this. So no problem if you don't have all the products at this point. So Sunday will be the mixed media. Hi, Charlie. Sunday will be the mixed media seahorse. These classes have already been done here in Prince George and Kelowna, but we're doing these in the UK as well. So Dali has all the embellishments and everything, and the kit's ready to go there. And then the Steampunk Maiden that lights up, this will be on Saturday morning. So Saturday morning and Sunday morning, I'm going to be busy doing Facebook Lives for the private group. So if you're interested, hit me up, let me know. You can also get your kits and everything and all the information at www.daliartmarket.co.uk. So I'll put those aside. What else have I got here? So I put out a card kit the other day. I have only 2 left, so I wanted to show them quickly how simple it is by taking a 12 by, these are done by 2 12 by 12 sheets. Here is one. It's a Pink Christmas by Stamperia. Hi, Nikki. And I've obviously embellished it with some 3D pens. So the kit has two of the same. And they come with envelopes. And this is the other one. And those, I have a couple that I have to go drop off this week. This is the second one to it. And then this is the third one to it. So they're about 5x5. And they, like I said, they're 6 cards. They come with envelopes. Only 2 sets left. And let's move on to today's project. I'm going quite fast. I think it's because I'm not really prepared. Hi, Jill. So Jill, the workshops are done on Dali's website. For this side of the world, they're done through my Pip Art Creations. And then Paul can probably send you the link. For the UK and Europe, they're done through Dali's website. I think it's under Steampunk Maiden and Magical Seahorse. So, thanks, Paul. And then this is what I came up with. This is what I do when I don't have anything prepared. Is, let me see, which die cut have I not used yet but have, and that I really, really dying to use. And this is just an 8x8 canvas. And really, the most expensive item on here would actually just be the Merry Moose Tim Holtz Sizzix Thinless. He does amazing dies, and I work with his dies quite a bit. I just love them. They've got to be my favorite. So this is my take on the Merry Moose. It's a bit whimsical, but he still brings hope. And it's just a reverse canvas. You're welcome, Jill. Just a reverse canvas. This is really simple. All this stuff you can just find at your regular pound shop or dollar store, other than the die and the paper here. So really, the star of the show today is the Tim Holtz die. So this is just a great die. I'm going to be using, you've seen me use this quite a bit, it's the Stamperia Twinkle Twinkle stencil. It's the one that I used on my baby boy box. And the other one that I'm using is, which we just had a special on, is the Rustic Festive Paper Stack by Becky Seadon with the matching stamps. But I'm not using the matching stamps today. But I just wanted to show you quickly. It doesn't matter, really, the background that you use on these. I could have used any of these backgrounds to create this. I mean, look at this one. I could have used any of these backgrounds. So I wanted to quickly show you it on your color palette, whatever you want to use. This one would have been a lovely one to use too. It all depends on what your color palette is, but there's a color for everyone to make the Merry Moose. They're just absolutely stunning. This is an A4. There's 40 sheets in here, believe it or not, but I won't go through all of them. The one that I'm using is this one right here. I don't know why I have a shadow there, but it's my light, I think. Is this one right here. Okay. But I can go on and show you any of these would have worked. This one may be a little bit too dark, but really, really beautiful. So that's a Peggy's, my friend Peggy. There's Becky Seadon's book, 40 pages. Now, another interesting one was these that I was actually initially thinking of using. They're already cut to a size. They look like an 8x10. And these have really gorgeous colors too. So this would really take out the guesswork of just cutting down here and doing the die on there. But I've chosen to go with my paper that I have. This one was my second choice, actually, this one right here. But I didn't use it. I could use it today. Okay, so this is really simple, really straightforward. It's not a hard canvas to make. I would actually call this a beginner's canvas. So Here it is. Okay. And I'm only going to very quickly go through the products because I don't even know if I grabbed all of them, but I will. So talking about Tim Holtz, you know, I love working with his distress oxide. So I've got vintage photo and I have black soot. Let's see, what else do we have here? I have so much on my table today, it's not even funny. So I'm just going to bring my whole little basket over. We got the white primer paste. We're going to use structure paste today for my snow. We got snow crystal paste. We got some of the large 3D balls. We got silver stencil paste. We've got a bunch of media mists. What else do we have in here? Crackling paste and crackling primer. Those are my embellishments. Some 3D pens, a snow pen, finishing wax brown, and white acrylic paint, and then my 3D varnish for glue. I know, it's all over the place today. But I don't want to miss my Facebook Live. Honestly, I didn't think I was going to do it with everything down. Murphy's Law, it came up. Okay. I'm just going to blow my nose. It's just one of those days, you know, when you have an off day. Oh, excuse me. Okay, so the first thing that you want to do... I'm just going to move these all out of the way. The first thing that you want to do... is I've already cut this to size from the Becky C. Dunn Rustic Festive book. This is just an 8x8 canvas. I hate the way that that camera is casting a shadow, but I can't change it. It's gonna stay there for some reason. No, it wants to stay there. Okay, so we have the 8x8 canvas, which we're gonna reverse. I've taken a page out of the rustic pad, and basically all we're going to do is I've cut it down so that I can get it under the corners. So the very first thing that we're going to do is just get some glue. And honestly, I don't think too much about this. I'm just going to put some glue down. This is so simple to create a background with papers like this. Sometimes that's my starting point. I actually pick out the paper and then I decide what I'm going to do with it. In this case, I knew I had to work with something that was going to be easy for me to put together quickly, relatively quickly. So I wanted to work with a die. Hadn't worked with this one. And in this case, actually, I went for the paper after the fact. I saw the Merry Moose and I thought, oh, he needs a nice light background because he's dark himself. So that's it. That's all you're going to do. And then come in and squeeze in your paper. I'm keeping my snowflakes towards the top. Don't worry about it too much right now because you can flip your canvas around, and then we're just going to come in and we're just going to put this down and then just tuck it underneath. So if you already have it cut to size, it is really easy to just tuck underneath like so. Okay. See, now already you have a lovely, lovely background to work on, but these papers do lend themselves really well. Look at that. It's already, hi Diane. It's already looking lovely, lovely, lovely. Next, what we're going to do, and I'm going a little bit fast today because we have lots to get through to today because I didn't think out my Facebook Live. Now, what we're going to do is, here's that stencil, Twinkle Twinkle Little Star. And we're just going to use the top part of it because the bottom part, we've got the moose and the trees. It doesn't really matter though, because the stars, I don't know if you can see them, they're quite subtle in the background. Obviously, if I tilt a little bit, you can see them giving a little bit of a shimmer there. So, hi Karen. Let's go and find our stencil paste. So I'm using Pentart stencil paste silver. And like I said, this is really just straightforward. I'm not going in too thick. You could go in thicker if you wanted to. And I'm just gonna put down some stars. And the reason I'm doing this first is because this takes a little bit of time to dry, but I'm not gonna be touching this part, so it's easy for me to just deal with it now. And you can put your stars wherever you want, randomly or however you choose to. I just brought mine just a tad little bit down to the bottom here because I just wanted them to kind of just slightly be behind the little Mary Moose. I haven't given him a name yet. Could call him Murray the Moose. That's it. Just a nice little sprinkling of the stars. And I will give you a close-up of that. After I clean my stencil on the floor here, running out of room. Put the lid back on that. Now I probably could have pressed this down a little bit more to stick it to the canvas, but I did not. Okay, stencil is nice and clean. Let me see if you can see the stars now. Do you see how gorgeous those are? Good morning, Gloria. Is James there with you? Good morning, James. There we go. So you can see how gorgeous those stars look now. They're absolutely lovely. I love this stencil paste because you can go as delicate as you want and you can go as thick as you want. So I've gone very delicate here. So that's a silver stencil paste. Okay, now what we're going to do, because we're going to be crackling this, we're going to go ahead and start with putting primer on this so that we can actually get this part out of the way. So we're going to start off with the Pentart crackling paste primer, and this is component one. Okay, move my gesso over so I don't accidentally do that. So I'm just gonna really put this on really fast. But of course, at home, as I always say, take your time. So what you wanna do is just give it a nice quick coat with the primer. And I chose, like, even though there's a primer that, crackling, Pentart crackling paste that is already blue, Victorian blue, I think it's called, so you don't have to color it. I could have used that, it would have matched well, but I really wanted a little bit of white poking out, so I don't want to have to then repaint over it. I prefer to do it this way because my canvas is quite a light color. It's not like a steampunky rustic kind of color or a shabby chic kind of color, so that's my reason for going with the white. Okay, so we've got that part done. I put my finger in there and let's just come over the top. This is how late I was working. I've got paint on my hand that I haven't even managed to get off yet. Not too concerned about the stars because they're quite dry now. So I'm very fortunate that that dries fast and because I went on so thin. Am I frozen, guys? Thanks, Debbie. Okay, so we have a nice little layer of the primer down. Now what I'm gonna do is I'm actually just gonna let this sit for a little bit and we will move on to our next step. Let me wash that brush out. So the next step will be the crackle paste. But before we do that, let's move on to our next step. So I'm just going to move this guy out of the way there. See, I've got my red sweater on for the color red this month. And the next thing that we're going to do is we are going to come in and I'm going to do the mousse now. So the mousse is going to be die cut. So I will do that on the side. Again, the die cut that I'm using is the Tim Holtz Merry Mousse. So I'm just going to pull this out. Oops, there's his antlers. And just put this off to the side. It's such a cute die. And you can use this technique in your card making too. So here's all the pieces that you get. For some reason, mine does not have his little bell. So that's why I had to make my own little bell. Because mine didn't have one. I don't know whether I've dropped it or it's somewhere here. I don't know. Okay, so let's put this aside. Now, I don't know how well you can see on here. The little Merry Mousse is not cut out, is not done on regular cardstock because I wanted it to have some texture. So it's actually just done on watercolor card to give it some texture. And also because the technique that I'm using on it allows me to put a lot of water on there. So if you can see, he's kind of got two colors on him. He's got like a graphite color and a beautiful brown color. So he is not one color. And the same with his antlers. Now the beauty of this is you're just going to create this whole piece using a brown, a graphite, and of course the red. Same for the trees. So we're only using three media mists, okay? So let me show you how I did that. So this is going to take a little bit of drying. So just bear with me as I dry it to create the look that I'm going for. Okay, maybe I better move this out the way before I hit it and make it all dirty. Okay, so I've got my trusty bare flat box. Hi, Judy. Now I've got some clear paper down. So this is going to be my mousse, okay? So the first thing that I'm going to do just to give it a nice base is I'm just going to spray some water on my watercolor paper here. Nothing too much. I'm just going to spray it down. And then the next step that I'm going to do is I am going to, and I should have cleaned the nozzle on this and I didn't, come in with some of my brown here. So this is just a brown media mist, come with a little bit of water. And all I'm trying to do at this point is create a bit of a background for the mousse. Okay. Then you can change up your colors, make the mousse as dark as you want, as light as you want. Okay. So I'm going to dry this right away. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to come in with some more brown because we want this nice and darker. And this is what allows you to have the different variations of brown on the mousse because some of him will be darker and some of him will be lighter. And if you want, you can even come in to give it even further darker spots because it's just nice for him to not be one continuous color. Okay. Okay, so you can keep on making him browner and browner. This is a technique that you would continue to follow to keep him going browner. You see the different tones that the mousse is going to be right here. He's going to be a few different tones. And this is kind of what I'm going for right here. A little bit of dark and light. And that really makes it look like he's like a little furry animal. Now, the next color that I'm going to come in with is the graphite. So that was the Pentart Medium Mist. This is the Stamperia graphite color. And with this, I'm just going to kind of strategically, just not strategically, but just put this down and not spray it down, because I want him to have some random dark spots on him, but not all over. Because mousse aren't one color, right? So now look at your mousse. He's going to have some really nice variations on him, okay? So let's just give that a quick dry. And see the texture now, because of that watercolor? See how it's got a different texture to it than had you used it on cardstock? So that's it. That's our mousse done until we cut him out. But I'll see if you can see all the different colors of what that mousse is going to be. And you did this just using watercolor paper and the graphite aqua color and the medium mist brown by Pentart. Okay, so that's our mousse done. Now, in terms of the antlers, they are quite light because obviously you want them to stand out, and antlers are lighter. So what we're going to do is I'm going to come in with a lot of water here, and I'm just going to soak up what is on there, just like this. So now we have these lovely antlers, and look at the nice little variations the antlers are going to have. Oh, thanks, Lynette. So you have this gorgeous technique. His antlers, like, no antlers are going to be perfectly white, right? So we have the mousse, and then we have his antlers that are from the same color family. Now, the next step is, I'm going to keep on going with the browns. Now I'm going to do the trees. So I have a little bit of brown tree. I have like a graphite-y gray tree, and I have a lighter brown tree. And again, this is just playing with the brown colors that you have. So what I'm going to do is, let me see. I better cut this because otherwise all my trees are going to be the same. So I'm just going to take my die cut, and I'm just going to cut off a piece here, and then I'm going to do another piece here. And hopefully this fits onto the last one. Yay! Okay. Just because I want my trees to be different variations, I don't want them to be the same. So because we're working with the brown, let's just stick with the brown. Don't worry if you get stuff over it, you're going to color this anyway. So let's do some brown here. And I want my trees to be quite dark. So I'm not going to bring on this for this tree, I want it to be dark. I'm not going to bring any water onto this. Oh, well, it's a little bit wet anyway. And again, you're just building up the color for your tree, okay? And just continue to keep building it up. Bring a little bit more in. There's no waste or want in this, because you just keep going and picking up the color. No, I could keep going and making this darker, but in the interest of time, I'm not going to. But one of the other colors, sorry, I did introduce into my tree was a medium as turquoise green. And I just, again, just brought this one in on its own like this, just so that my tree could have some different variation rather than it kind of being all over the place. And see, now my tree will look, it's got some nice color textures going on. The key to this is to dry in between before picking up the next color, okay? Okay, so there's one tree. Those are the antlers. Oh, here's another set of trees. So let's bring in a little bit of brown. I want to go a lot darker than what I've been going. So I'm not putting any water down in this because I need this to be quite dark. So you see the difference when you don't introduce water to your cardstock or water to your base. Because I need my trees to be darker because I want them to stand out. I'm going to leave this one that color and I will show you, I will die cut them and then I will re-come in with the medium mist because I want to show you it's easier to pick it up once you've die cut it more color. And this one I'm going to make a little bit more charcoal-y. But this is going to be it for this part of the technique. So don't worry, we're just about done. And now I'm just going to introduce a little bit of the gray because this tree I want to be. So now you got three trees that are different colors, slightly different colors. And it's good because no tree is alike, right? So now I'm just going to dry. Okay, so we have everything done, so give me 1 second. I'm just going to die cut the trees because I've still got some work to do on that. So give me 1 second. Is there any questions there? Oh, thank you, Charlie. Now let's hope I don't goof up with the die cutting, otherwise we'll be missing trees. So here's one tree. Here's the other tree. The last tree. So for me, they're still a little bit too light, and this is why I wanted to keep my little board out here. And to me, they're quite similar still. Let's see if I can't show you guys. So this is what they look like. Well, you can't see them on my brown hand, can you? So what you do here, one, I'm gonna keep this shade because I need a lighter tree, so he's fine. He's not fine. I want to bring in a little bit of the graphite. So what you can do at this point is now really just concentrate on the actual tree. Okay. So you can just go in, dip it in. And now look at the variation you're going to get. So now let me show you the change in that tree if you can see it. I don't know. But see how it's got the dark parts on it too and the brown? So that's what you're going for, a different look. One, I want to be greener. So let's bring in a little bit more green. And the more you go in, obviously, and dry, and the more you come back, the darker it's going to go, right? So if you want to make things really dark, then this is what you would do. And that goes the same for the moose and the antlers and everything else. So... there's that one, really dark. It's kind of hard to see it with all this mess behind. So there we go. Okay, so now, once we've done that, what we're gonna do is we're gonna take our moose and we're gonna cut them out. Moose is so cute. Okay, so I'm gonna find a place where I think it's got lots of variation. And I'm just gonna put him down on there. I forgot to do his little harness and collar thing, which I will do. But see how much like texture he has, and he looks like he's hairy. He's got hair on him. Thanks, Di. But doesn't he look different than using regular cardstock? And then let's do the antlers. Now, just so you know, in the packet of the Tim Holtz dye, I didn't use this. You also get this little dye, and it's a green tree tops for your trees, but I'm not using it. And I'm going to find a place for my gorgeous little antlers. So just look for areas on your cardstock, on your watercolor paper that kind of speak to you. And then we have his gorgeous little antlers. And see the little different colors on the antlers? Don't they look like real antlers? So that will go there. Now I forgot to do his harness, which is not a big deal, because all we need to do is to just, yep, let's flip this over. Look, Di, I'm doing Dali special. And then for the harness, all I used was the red and a little bit of graphite. Oopsie daisy, where's my paper? I want to really get that super red, so I'm just going to show you. Look how bright that red is. So I only need very little, because this is not, it's just his harness and his little collar here. And once I've got this color down, I'm going to show you again. It's just about drying this. And then once you've dried it, come in with your second color. I need to clean my nozzle on this. Okay, so I'm going to keep this very, very red. Okay. See how red that is? This is my red entry, my inspiration for red. You see how red that is? But for this one, what I'm gonna do is I'm also gonna bring in just a little bit of gray. Again, this is just about giving your die cuts a different look, a buildup of texture, if you will. So there we go. I'm just gonna dry this. I'll spritz some water on this. and then I'm gonna dry it. I just want it to smooth out a bit more. So it's still not red enough for me. So you can come directly on the paper. Of course, you can spray it on and not drop it on like I'm doing. I'm doing that because I need to clean my nozzle. See, anything goes in mixed media, doesn't it? Because you're not going for a really, really clean look, per se. Note to self, clean my nozzles after using. Don't leave the lid off. No, no longer clean, Daya, you're right. Ouch. Okay, now we're done with the box. Now we are done with the box. I'm just going to pick up some of that extra paint there. But I hope you can see the different variations in that red now. Okay, so let's just get this die cut and then we can get on with it. Tiny little pieces, don't want to lose them. I think I've already, like I said, lost his bell. I think that's it, I'm done for my little die cuts here. I don't need this piece, it's just a piece off the end. I'm just going to take out his. Oh, you guys can't even see me, can you? Thank you, Debbie. So this is his little harness. And the harness actually does come with these two red little dots. But I'm just to put on top to make it look like buckles, I guess. But I'm just going to 3D mine. And then this is his little collar thing, which, like I said, I don't know what happened to my bell. So we're going to take that out. Okay, so what I'm going to do is check on that primer. Here's all my little die cuts. See, this is all we have. We don't have many die cuts. We just have this. We have the antlers, we have the Merry Moose, and then we have the three different colored trees. Okay, so this is all we're gonna be working with. Now, so this is dry now. So while we were waiting, this is dry. So let's just go and work with this for now. Let's just trade this around. So this is a bit of a long class today. Because I've just got so much to show you. But it comes together really quick. So, in terms of doing the crackle paste, I just like to just go at it with my spatula. I'm not looking for a thin crackle. I wanted a chunky crackle because he's quite dainty. And I wanted something a little bit more chunkier. So this is it. You're just going to... Don't worry about it, just spread it on. It will be what it will be. Just spread it on and pray to the crackle gods, and it should be fine. And that's it, that's all I'm doing. Can you see? I'm just, I'm not sure the lighting's the best there, but I am just taking a little chunk out and I'm just putting it on. Take a little chunk out, dig deep in there. And just spread it on like so. Let's see if I can't use my left hand. That might be a little bit easier. So I'm just going to work all the way around. And I just putting it down and pulling it across, putting it down and pulling it across. So put a bit down and just pull it across. That's all you need to do. And that primer dries really fast, so we're lucky. No drying involved. So I like to think I do things in an order that tries to save me from doing the least amount of drying possible, but it doesn't always work that way, right? And I'll show you on when I put this down, what I mean, just put a bit down and drag it. Put a bit down and drag it. Otherwise, you're going to end up with a really uniform look. And I don't like that. I like my cracks to be different sizes and different looks. So there we have it. So all I basically do is I just put a little bit down like this. And then I just spread it across like this. And I'm trying to cover my staples here. That's the main goal. And just spread it, make sure you get the sides. Now you could crackle on the inside too, if you wanted, but you would need to have done primer under there. Just put a bit down and then just spread it on through like this, okay? Just spread it on through. Put a bit down, spread it through. You get the idea. It's like a messy buttercream icing. Now, I'd like to work with my canvas rather than against my canvas. So for me, it's just a matter of turning my paper around, but that didn't work. Oopsie daisy, I'm getting this everywhere today. Die, I am, I'm becoming a messy person. So put a bit down, spread it across. And then what we can do, as I like to say, is let this percolate while we carry on building our scene. Now you can do the crackle right at the end too if you want to. You don't have to do it in the order that I've done it. So whatever works for you. At home you have the beauty of being able to walk away and come back once your crackle is all nice and dry. I'm going on quite thick, believe it or not. Usually I go on thin when I'm doing a Facebook Live, but I'm very confident with the Pentart crackle that it will dry with a heat gun and not impact the crackle, especially the white crackle. So that's why I'm being quite generous for my chunky cracks. A little bit more here, so I get a little bit chunkier. Okay, that's it. We're done with this. So that was just the Pentart crackling paste that I use. Hi, Min. You know what, Min? I was just thinking about you, and I just looked up and saw you on the computer. I was thinking, I haven't seen Min today, or maybe I missed Min saying hi. And there's a thing in our East Indian culture that if you're thinking of somebody and all of a sudden they call or they pop up or you get a message from them, it means that they have a very long, healthy life ahead of them. So you're going to be around for a long time, my friend, which is brilliant. Okay, so now we have the crackle done on here and everything, let's move on to the next step. So what we're going to do is we're going to assemble our little Murray the Moose while we just set this crackle aside. And I'm just going to also, while I'm at it, I don't know why I stick my stuff down and then I come and play around with the snow pens and the rainbow pens and the 3D pens. But because I'm going to let my crackle dry for a little bit, I am going to go and decorate them right away. That will make sense in a minute when I do that. So I'm just going to pull this off, put it aside somewhere I'm not going to step on it. And let's bring these guys together. So here we have the little Merry Moose. Okay, you guys know my glue job. It's not the best. So let's have a look. Do I even have glue? I know I have glue because I brought glue. Okay, so let's see. What do I have here? Okay, this is okay. Don't get too excited. This is just how I glue. We're just going to take a little skewer here and tap some glue on here. I was going to do it on the back of my hand. That's fine too. You can do that. Oh, yo. You can do that too. I mean, I was just saying today I'm kind of going super fast because... I did it wrong. I'm supposed to have to distress these first. So we're going to wipe off the glue. Okay, we're going to wipe off the glue. I'm going so fast, I forgot my next step. I'm thinking like, God, they look a little bit anemic, don't they? This is where the amazing Tim Holtz stuff comes in. So you watch this little plain mousse now turn into a gorgeous, gorgeous, good for you men, turn him into a nice, handsome looking gentleman. So the first thing that I did was I just came in and gave him just an overall, just a little dusting of the vintage photo distress oxide to give him a bit of more, even further matte look. Okay, I also did that with the antlers, just gave it a very, very gentle dusting, very, very gentle, because you don't want to take the color away. Okay, so just a very gentle dusting on him. Now, I also, believe it or not, did this on the trees. Okay. So just a very nice little gentle. Of course, take your time at home. I'm going quite fast here. I probably wouldn't be doing this, obviously, if I was doing it. Taking my time. Next color you want to bring in, and this is really where don't be afraid to use your black distress oxide, like your black suit, because it really is going to make a difference on how stuff looks. But the neat thing about it is, this is a distress ink. The other one was a distress oxide. The neat thing about this is that the media mist is still gonna show through, okay? It is still gonna show through, so I don't want you to be concerned about it. Now, with the antlers, you just wanna do the bottom part where it's gonna be close to his head, okay? That's all you want to do, and I will show you what his antlers look like on this white piece of paper so you can see. So they look like this. So just at the bottom part, can you see? So he's got shading at the bottom, but you keep the brown medium mist area at the top. So those are his little antlers. And then you want to do the same with the little Murray here. You want to come in and you want to darken some edges. So for him, I did quite a dark area around him because for me, that's what gives him a lot of contrast. And then with his feet, I went super dark. Don't ask me why. And then around his face. He's so cute. Okay, that's it. You're all distressed up. I will show you the mousse now. So you can see him. He's like a few different colors now. But you see how he's got that gorgeous like shadow around him? He is also quite regal. Okay, now I can glue. So bring up my trusty little glue thing here. Obviously, like I said, when you're at home, do this properly. Don't rush it. and glue him down. Yeah, be a lot more gentle than I am. So this is what he looks like now. He's got like a 3D antler thing going on. Okay. And then this one's a little bit tricky, so we will put that one on our hand. And this will go like, better double check that. I think this goes like this. Right underneath, oopsie daisy, right there. Okay. And then we have his little collar. I'm just gonna tap a little bit onto my hand here. And then let's put his collar on him. Okay, so there you have your little Merry Moose, but can you see the different variations of color on him? How realistic he's starting to look and how he's got that texture going on? I wish you guys could see it in real life. Okay, so next thing that you're gonna do is, I have these little berry things here. So what I'm going to do is I'm just gonna pull off a berry. And then I'm going to take this berry and I'm just going to, they're polystyrene, so I'm just going to cut the berry in half like this. Okay, I'll take the half that I want. I should probably do this after because I don't know if I can keep it on there. And then we're just going to stick him down for his little bell there, because like I said, I don't know what has happened. So there he is, he's got his little bell. It's a bit of a big bell, but that's okay. He can be the king of the forest there. And then the next thing that you want to do is, this is where you can come in and you can start playing with your 3D pens. So I have my snow pen here. And what I did with my snow pen was I cut it off a lot more. Because I was in such a rush, I was dying to get it out, that I cut it all off. And then all I'm going to do is just, that's it, just give it the trees a nice little dusting, just like this in my hand, nothing too exciting, and do that on all your trees. And it, when you do it fast like this and it's not deliberate, see how the snow actually looks like snow sitting on the tree, rather than when you go really deliberate with it. That's two trees done. What happens is, because I've cut a thicker nib, look at how nice that really looks, like there's snow sitting on it. I don't know if you can tell, but it really does. And then what you want to do, you can bring a little bit onto the Merry Moose's feet. Little Murray there. I did a little bit down on his antlers, just because that's the one place where he's probably going to have snow. If you get too much on, you can just take it out. And I'm just going to use my finger. I've got a little bit on my mat here. And I'm just going to use my finger and I'm just going to give him some in strategic areas. And that's it. So now that you have all that done, we're ready to assemble. I'm just going to use my 3D pen here. And I am just going to do his little collar here and give it a couple of 3D dots. I'm going to do that for his harness too. Okay. Then I'm going to use my black 3D pen. And I am going to give him a little black eye. Like, not pinching black eye, but a black eye. Now he's a little bit wet, but I will show you what he looks like when he's all done. So do you see his little black eye there? His little 3D eye, little bit of snow all over him. And I just, the antlers are what get me. I just love those antlers. So there you have the Merry Moose. And here are your three trees, okay? So they are all ready to go. So we're going to put those aside now. We're doing a lot of putting aside. Like I said, this is quite an aggressive Facebook Live in the sense that there's a lot going on here. So I do appreciate your patience with me. And let's now go and bring back the crackling part of this. So nothing's cracked yet. I hope that was primer I used. I'm in trouble if I didn't. Nothing's cracked yet, but that's okay, because we are going to take the heat gun to it. Okay, so just bear with me while I take the heat gun, okay? Thank you, Lynette. Thank you, Debbie. Okay, it's not completely dry, but look at the chunky crackle going on there. It is so chunky, but I like that. Okay, you'll see it more pronounced once we start doing the paint over it. So the next step is, then this is where you can decide, I mean, you could have your, doesn't mean that you can't have your stenciling stars coming this way. He could be going into the stars could be this way, but my intention was to have it this way with my snowflakes down here. So I won't probably take my time gluing stuff down, to be honest, but what you can start doing here is start having a look at how you want to lay this out. I'm just gonna tuck this guy under there for a minute. So I'm just tucking him in under there because I just want to see what my layout's gonna look like. Okay, and chuck that in there. So for me, this guy is too long, so I'm just gonna come and snip a little bit off. I don't want my trees to all be the same size, if you will. Okay, this guy's too long for me, so I'm gonna snip a little bit of him off. Okay, so I won't take my time drying that, gluing it. And then I've got my little Merry Moose, and I'm gonna give him like, where are they? I'm going to give him like really thick pop-ups, like really thick ones, so that he can really pop up. Okay. Make sure everything's dry. That's why I like coming in with my 3D pen towards the end part of it. And then at this point, you can pop down your little Merry Moose, who we've named Murray. Okay. Now, I do have a few things. If you want to, you can play around and use different twigs, and you can put them down here to further build your canvas in the bottom like that. It's entirely up to you. You can use whatever elements you want. But I'm going to be doing snow down there, so we're going to leave that for now like this. Okay, the next step is just take some greens, some berries, and you can go, thank you, Lynette, you can go any color, thank you, Debbie, any color that you want. Okay, so all I'm going to do is take some off here, and I'm just gonna use one of these plier things, I'm not sure what they're called, and let's take some off here. And I won't take my time gluing these down, but basically you're gonna tuck this just a tad bit under there, and then what you can do is just bring this around like this. Okay, but I'm not going to take my time to glue it down. I'll just leave it popped up in there because it gives you an idea of what I'm trying to do. And then if you want, you can bring in a baby one. So this is stuff that you probably still got at home. Bring in a baby one and just tuck it under there like this. Okay, now to make that fit in with the Christmas scene, what we're going to do is we are gonna give it a little bit of dusting with the Pentart primer, white primer. Just because we want it all to tie in, okay? We want it all to tie in. Okay, and then what you want to do is you can bring your snow pen, wherever I've put my snow pen, I'll put it aside somewhere. I can't see my snow pen. Oh, there it is. Your snow crystal effect pen, your snow crystal pen. And then what you can do is just do a little bit of light dusting just to give it a look of that it's got frost on it and a little bit of snow. This will further give you that 3D effect look. And you can just keep going down. Okay, so you get the idea there. Okay, so now we're on to basically coming on to the last bits. This is still a little bit wet, but we're gonna go ahead and finish that off. This will obviously go here. You don't have to have anything in there at all if you don't want to. So the next thing we're going to do is we're going to come in with the aqua color water green, because it matches really well. And all I'm going to be doing is I'm just going to be placing some down across my canvas, okay? Because I don't want my canvas to be stark white. basically. I want it to have some kind of a bluey hue to it. Now what I'll do, I won't do the sides. I have done them on my other canvas because otherwise I'm going to have you guys here all day. So what I'm actually going to do is I'm just going to put a little bit into a pot here and just paint it on because that'll be faster. And then I'll show you what it looks like where you have it and where you don't. So you can see how that's starting to tie in even more where it's not stark white. Then you can come in and lift a little bit off, just like this. And just keep going all the way around. You don't need a lot, as you can see. My crackle is still a slightly bit damp. So I would do this on all around the sides. But you will see already that this is starting to give more of a nice icy Christmas kind of hue, if you will. So you can see it now. See how it's kind of got that icy effect to it? Right? So it's got a nice icy effect to it. Okay, so the next thing that we're going to do is we are going to build up the bottom of the canvas. So I've got so much stuff going on here today. So can you see at the bottom, we've got snow, and it really looks like somebody's been traipsing through the snow, because sometimes when you go through, thank you, Charlie, when you go through a forest or where there's moose around, in my mind, you're not going to have dead straight snow. It's going to be kind of like this, crumpled and trampled on. So this is my trampled kind of look snow. And if you have a look, it's almost got tones of blue in it also. And that is the snow effect paste, picking up the light from the blue background there. Okay, so what we're going to do, we're going to first build it up with structure paste. So this is structure paste, and structure paste is exactly that. It's a thick, gooey structure paste. Okay, then what we're going to do is we're going to drop some 3D large balls in there, because this is what's going to give it that rocky kind of effect, because you have lots of rocks and big stones in the forest. And then we're going to top it off with the crystal effect, because this is kind of translucent, if you will. And what it will do, it will allow it to pick up the blue color from the background, giving it a further crystal effect. Put the lid on this because we don't want this to spill. And so let's start. And what I will do, I'll do a thin layer just to give you guys a gist of what this is going to look like. Otherwise, we'll be here a long time. So, oopsie daisy. I'm just going to tuck this tree back in. I'm just tucking it in for now. I'll have to come back and glue it later. You take your structure paste. I don't know how easy this is going to be to see. And just scrape it off the back like this, okay? Just scrape it off the back and start putting this down. And you can go as high as you want, as low as you want, and make sure your trees are glued, because this is what will happen to them if they're not glued. Okay, but you see how that's already looking like crumply snow? And it's very fluffy. And this is where you want, and you can start dropping your little 3D balls in, just to give it that further little look. But can you see how that's looking like a rocky kind of snow place? So I'm just going to continue doing that all the way down. This is so light and fluffy, this structure paste, so it really works well. Snow paste is, oopsie daisy. Snow paste is great too. You can use snow paste. It's a little bit heavier and grittier than this. I like this because this just looks so much fresher and fluffier, and I just really liked it. And the structure paste, because it is a structure paste, allows you to structure it obviously a lot better. I'm just going to do that corner. So just strategically put it down in there. Probably don't need that much. I'm just going to have my sides a little bit higher just for aesthetic purposes. And then this is again where you can bring in now your little art stones. And what you can also do at this point is take a little bit of this structure paste, just like this, and you can even introduce it into your sides to give it further dimension, okay? So don't be afraid of just taking stuff and putting it places. Don't want you to be afraid. Okay, so that's the structure paste done. Get the right lid for it. Now let's go in and drop in some of these balls to give it even more of a nice rocky feeling. And it's too bad that you can't quite see how good these little rocks work, but I'm just dropping them in just randomly to create a really nice rocky little. So I don't know if you can see them. Can you see how lovely and rocky they look? So just tap them in so that they're going to stick there. Probably put them in a little bit more strategically than me. And then in order for you to get that kind of crystal-y look that picks up the paper, because this has got like a translucent look to it, this is where you can just come in and put some of this snow down and you will be able to tell right away it's starting to already pick up that blue hue. You can see it right there, picking up the blue hue compared to where it's super white down here. There is a reason why I do certain things. Okay, that's it. So I'm not going to, like I said, spend too much time building this up. But now you get what he looks like in his little snowy little forest there. Okay, and because this is all wet, the 3D balls will stay stuck as it dries. So let's put that away. And we've got a last few things to do, and then I will let you lovely people go. The next thing you want to do is get your finishing wax. This is optional, not everybody likes this. Let me just pop that off. Get your finishing wax and we are just going to grab a fresh baby wipe. We're nearly done. Okay, so all you're going to do is take this and put it around. This just ties everything into place. You can leave it this dark. You can lighten this up. It's entirely up to you. I will be lightening my slightly up, but the reason I'm doing this is because I need this to get into the cracks so that the cracks are very, very prominent. Now this would work with antique paste Umbra too. It's just that I like the smell of this one. So if you wanted it really vintagey, you could leave it this dark. That's entirely up to you. But my main goal here is to get into those cracks. Okay. So once you've done this, what you're going to do is you're going to take your baby wipe and you're going to start pulling back on this so that most of it remains in the cracks. Okay. Now, if you go in really hard, what will happen? What I've done here is where you see it really, really white is where I've really, hi Patricia, really used my baby white really quite hard because I wanted some of the white elements to still show through. I didn't want it just to be brown and blue. So once you have this here, you're just going to pick up certain areas where you want it to pull it back, okay? And certain areas where you don't. Now, I'll give you a classic example of why you want to put that brown down when I was talking about it being in the cracks. So I'll show you right here. Can you see how gorgeous those cracks look now and how vintage they look? So that is a reason that you're coming in with the crackle paste, the brown finishing wax, okay? So you can pull this back as much as you want, do some white areas like I'm doing right here, or you can leave it as dark as you want, okay? It all depends on your elbow grease that you want to use and the look that you're going for, right? I want this a little bit whiter, so I'm just coming in. As you can see, I've whitened that little area up, but now I don't like it because it's too white, but I will fix that later. And then you're just going to keep coming and doing that. This is where my crackle paste is wet, so I'm not going to touch that side because otherwise it's going to take it right off. The other key is to make sure your crackle paste is dry. But you guys get the idea of what you're doing there, okay? So there you have it. Last but not least, I have this little bell. And I have these twigs, which I actually have. I don't have them on my website, but I do sell them. Some things I just don't have on my website because I like to be greedy and keep for myself. Isn't that rude? I'm just going to put this through here, like so. It's just a little bell. Take our 3D varnish. Oh, let's tuck this under here before we forget. I'll glue these down after. And let's take our 3D varnish, prop it on. Oopsie daisy. Put this there. It's not going to stay. Let's change this up a little bit, shall we? Okay, 3D glue probably would have worked better. And if you want at this time, you can put some snow paste on it. Or a 3D white pen, whatever tickles your fancy. But you could actually take your snow paste and just dust this off a little bit like this, just so that it looks like it's part of the project. Okay, sorry guys if today was super rushed, but as you can see, there was so much to this canvas, but this is what happens when I don't have time to think about what I'm going to do. I just go and do what I feel like, not realizing it's going to take me this long. So like I said, you could introduce more stuff. You don't have to do it the way that I've done it. You can put these little logs down at the bottom. It's entirely up to you. But I hope that from this, more than anything, you just got some different techniques of how to do different things and different ways of using stuff. Hi, Francis. And use your dies. Like, I'm really starting to use my dies a lot in my work, and I'm absolutely loving it. So there are the before and afters. They're very, very similar. I didn't really change up anything. This mousse has a lot more of the graphite on it. That one has less graphite on it. But there you have it. Thank you, Debbie. Thank you, Min. I hope you guys really enjoyed it. Just an 8x8 reverse canvas, couple of dies, things in your stash, and some products, and that's it. Thank you for bearing with me. I know it was an hour and a half today, but and I know I rushed, like super rushed, and maybe everything wasn't in the order that I would normally do it, but it's what made sense. So I hope you enjoyed them, and I hope you can see that lovely, lovely snow at the bottom. So nice and scrumptious. But everybody have a wonderful day. Thank you, Lynette. Everybody have a wonderful day and take care of each other. Be safe. No get-togethers. Let's do our part. Wear your mask. And I will see you guys next week, which is the last one. And then we're gonna take a 2-week break to rejuvenate. And Dali will be on tomorrow. And thank you, Terry. And thanks, Terry. That's so sweet. Thank you, Bonnie. And yeah, Dali will be on tomorrow and then Thursday. And again, the workshops are this Saturday and Sunday online. And I will see you all soon. Thank you for joining me. Thank you for bearing with me during this long Facebook Live. And I hope you go create your own little canvases. All right, everybody. Love you guys. Thank you, Charlie. Have a great day, everyone. Bye-bye.